The following is a free-for-download audiobook from the website krishnapath.org. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 7, Part 3, Chapter 12, The Perfect Society, Four Spiritual Classes. This chapter particularly describes the brahmachari and the person in the vanaprastha stage, and it also gives a general description for the four ashrams, brahmacharya, grihastha, vanaprastha, and sannyas. In the previous chapter, the great Saint Narada Muni has described the Varna institution of society, and now, in this chapter, he will describe the stages of spiritual advancement in the four ashrams, which are known as brahmacharya, grihastha, vanaprastha, and sannyas. The brahmachari should live under the care of the true spiritual master, giving him sincere respect and obeisances, acting as his menial servant and always carrying out his order. The brahmachari should engage himself in spiritual activities and study the Vedic literature under the direction of the spiritual master. According to the brahmacharya system, he should dress with a belt, a deerskin, matted hair, and should bear a danda, sacred water pot, and a sacred thread. And he should collect alms daily in the morning, and in the evening, whatever alms he has collected, he should offer to the spiritual master. A brahmachari should accept prasad upon the order of the spiritual master, and if the spiritual master sometimes forget to order the disciple to eat, the disciple should not take prasad on his own initiative, rather, he should fast. The brahmachari should be trained to be satisfied with eating what is absolutely necessary. He should be very expert in executing responsibilities. He should be faithful. He should control his senses and try to avoid the association of women as far as possible. A brahmachari should very strictly abstain from living with women and should not meet with grihasthas and those too addicted to women, nor should a brahmachari speak in a lonely place with a woman. After completing one's education as a brahmachari in this way, one should give dakshin, an offering of gratitude to one's guru, and then one may leave home for home and accept the next ashram, the grihastha ashram, or else one may continue in the brahmacharya ashram without adulteration. The duties for the grihastha ashram and the brahmacharya ashram, as well as the duties for sannyasis, are prescribed in the shastras. A grihastha is not meant to enjoy sex life without restriction. Indeed, the whole purpose of Vedic life is to become free from sexual indulgence. All the ashrams are recognized for spiritual progress, and therefore, although the grihastha ashram gives a kind of license for sex life for a certain time, it does not allow unrestricted sex life. Therefore, in grihastha life also, there is no illicit sex. A grihastha should not accept a woman for sexual enjoyment. Wasting semen is also illicit sex. After the grihastha ashram is another ashram known as vanaprastha, which is midway between grihastha and sannyas. A person in the vanaprastha order is restricted in eating food grains and forbidden to eat fruits that have not ripened on the tree. Nor should he cook food with fire, although he is allowed to eat charu, grains that have been offered in a sacrificial fire. He may also eat fruits and grains that have grown naturally. Living in a thatched cottage, the vanaprastha should endure all kinds of heat and cold. He should not cut his hair or nail, and he should give up cleaning his body and teeth. He should wear tree bark, accept a danda, and practice life in the forest, taking a vow to live there for 12 years, 8 years, 4 years, 2 years, or at least 1 year. At last, when because of old age he can no longer perform the activities of vanaprastha, he should eventually stop everything and in this way give up his body. Text 1. Narada Muni said, a student should practice completely controlling his senses. He should be submissive and should have an attitude of firm friendship for the spiritual master. With a great vow, the brahmachari should live at the gurukul only for the benefit of the guru. Text 2. At both junctions of day and night, namely in the early morning and in the evening, he should be fully absorbed in thoughts of the spiritual master, fire, the sun god, and Lord Vishnu, and by chanting the Gayatri Mantra, he should worship them. Text 3. Being called by the spiritual master, the student should study the Vedic mantras regularly. Every day, before beginning his studies and at the end of his studies, the disciple should respectfully offer obeisances unto the spiritual master. Text 4. Carrying pure kusha grass in his hand, the brahmachari should dress regularly with a belt of straw and with deerskin garments. He should wear matted hair, carry a rod and water pot, and be decorated with a sacred thread, as recommended in the shastras. Text 5. The brahmachari should go out morning and evening to collect alms, and he should offer all that he collects to the spiritual master. He should eat only if ordered to take food by the spiritual master. Otherwise, if the spiritual master does not give this order, he may sometimes have to fast. Text 6. A brahmachari should be quite well behaved and gentle and should not eat or collect more than necessary. He must always be active and expert, fully believing in the instructions of the spiritual master and the shastra. Fully controlling his senses, he should associate only as much as necessary with women or those controlled by women. Purport. A brahmachari should be very careful not to mix with women or men addicted to women. Although when he goes out to beg alms, it is necessary to talk with women and men who are very much attached to women, this association should be very short, and he should not talk with them, and he should talk with them only about begging alms and not more. A brahmachari should be very careful in associating with men who are too attached to women. Text 7. A brahmachari, or one who has not accepted the grihastha ashram family life, must rigidly avoid talking with women or about women, for the senses are so powerful that they may agitate even the mind of a sannyasi, a member of the renounced order of life. Purport. Brahmacharya essentially means the vow not to marry but to observe strict celibacy, brihadvrata. A brahmachari or sannyasi should avoid talking with women or reading literature concerning talks between men and women. The injunction restricting association with women is the basic principle of spiritual life. Associating or talking with women is never advised in any of the Vedic literatures. The entire Vedic system teaches one to avoid sex life so that one may gradually progress from brahmachari to grihastha, from grihastha to vanaprastha, and from vanaprastha to sannyas, and thus give up material enjoyment, which is the original cause of bondage to this material world. The word brihadvrata refers to one who has decided not to marry, in other words, not to indulge in sex life throughout his entire life. Text 8. If the wife of the spiritual master is young, a young brahmachari should not allow her to care for his hair, massage his body with oil, or bathe him with affection like a mother. Purport. The relationship between the student or disciple and the wife of the spiritual master or teacher is like that between son and mother. A mother sometimes cares for her son by combing his hair, massaging his body with oil, or bathing him. Similarly, the wife of the teacher is also a mother, Guru Patni, and therefore she may also care for the disciple in a motherly way. If the wife of the teacher is a young woman, however, a young brahmachari should not allow such a mother to touch him. This is strictly prohibited. There are 7 kinds of mothers. Atma Mata Guru Patni, Brahmani Raja Patnika, Dehur Datri Tata Prithvi, Saptai Ta Matara Shmita. These mothers are the original mother, the wife of the teacher or spiritual master, the wife of a brahmana, the king's wife, the cow, the nurse, and the earth. Unnecessary association with women, even with one's mother, sister, or daughter, is strictly prohibited. This is human civilization. A civilization that allows men to mix unrestrictedly with women is an animal civilization. In Kali Yuga, people are extremely liberal, but mixing with women and talking with them as equals actually constitute an uncivilized way of life. Text 9. Women woman is compared to fire, and man is compared to a butter pot. Therefore, a man should avoid associating even with his own daughter in a secluded place. Similarly, he should avoid association with other women. One should associate with women only for important business and not otherwise. Purport. If a butter pot and fire are kept together, the butter within the pot will certainly melt. Women are compared to fire, and man is compared to a butter pot. However advanced one may be in restraining the senses, it is almost impossible for a man to keep himself controlled in the presence of a woman, even if she is his own daughter, mother, or sister. Indeed, his mind is agitated even if one is in the renounced order of life. Therefore, Vedic civilization carefully restricts mingling between men and women. If one cannot understand the basic principle of restraining association between man and woman, he is to be considered an animal. That is the purport of this verse. Text 10. As long as a living entity is not completely self-realized, as long as he is not independent of the misconception of identifying with his body, which is nothing but a reflection of the original body and senses, he cannot be relieved of the conception of duality, which is epitomized by the duality between man and woman. Thus, there is every chance that he will fall down because his intelligence is bewildered. Purport. Here is another important warning that a man must save himself from attraction to women. Until one is self-realized, fully independent of the illusory conception of the material body, the duality of man and woman must undoubtedly continue, but when one is actually self-realized, this distinction ceases. Vidya vinaya sampane pramanika vihastini suni chaiva svaka pake cha pandita samadarshana. Quote, the humble sage, by virtue of true knowledge, sees with equal vision a learned and gentle brahmana, a cow, an elephant, a dog, and a dog-eater, outcast, end quote. Bhagavad Gita 5.18. On the spiritual platform, the learned person not only gives up the duality of man and woman, but also gives up the duality of man and animal. This is the test of spiritual realization. One must realize perfectly that the living being is a spirit soul, but is tasting various types of material bodies. One may theoretically understand this, but when one has practical realization, then he actually becomes a pundit, one who knows. Until that time, the duality continues, and the conception of man and woman also continues. In this stage, one should be extremely careful about mixing with women. No one should think himself perfect and forget the Shastric injunction that one should be very careful about associating even with his daughter, mother, or sister, not to speak of other women. Srila Madhvacharya cites the following shlokas in this regard. Bahut vinayva vastunam yartata gyanam uchite advaita gyanam ityetad dvaita gyanam tad anahita yata gyanam tata vastu yata vastu tatamati naiva gyana tayor bedas tata e kava vedanam. Until unity in variety is real knowledge, and therefore giving up variety artificially does not reflect perfect knowledge of monism. According to the Achintya Bheda philosophy of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, there are varieties, but all of them constitute one unit. Such knowledge is knowledge of perfect oneness. Text 11. All the rules and regulations apply equally to the householder and the sannyasi, the member of the renounced order of life. The grihastha, however, is given permission by the spiritual master to indulge in sex during the period favorable for procreation. Purport. It is sometimes misunderstood that a grihastha, a householder, is permitted to indulge in sex at any time. This is a wrong conception of grihastha life. In spiritual life, whether one is a grihastha, vanaprastha, sannyasa, or brahmachari, one is under the control of the spiritual master. For brahmacharis and sannyasis, there are strong restrictions on sexual indulgence. Similarly, there are strong restrictions for grihasthas. Grihasthas should indulge in sex life only in accordance with the orders of the guru. Therefore, it is mentioned here that one must follow the orders of the spiritual master, guru vritta vikalpena. When the spiritual master orders, the grihastha may accept sex life. This is confirmed in Bhagavad Gita 7.11. Dharma virudho bhuteshu kamosmi. Indulgence in sex life without disobedience to the religious rules and regulations constitutes a religious principle. The grihastha is allowed to indulge in sex life during the period favorable for procreation and in accordance with the spiritual master's order. If the spiritual master's order allows a grihastha to engage in sex life at a particular time, then the grihastha may do so. Otherwise, if the spiritual master orders against it, this grihastha should abstain. The grihastha must obtain permission from the spiritual master to observe the ritualistic ceremony of Garbhadhan Samskar. Then he may approach his wife to beget children, otherwise not. A brahmana generally remains a brahmachari throughout his whole entire life, but although some brahmanas become grihasthas and indulge in sex life, they do so under the complete control of the spiritual master. The kshatriya is allowed to marry more than one wife, but this also must be in accordance with the instructions of the spiritual master. It is not that because one is a grihastha, he may marry as many times as he likes and indulge in sex life as he likes. This is not spiritual life. In spiritual life, one must conduct one's whole life under the guidance of the guru. Only one who executes his spiritual life under the direction of the spiritual master can achieve the mercy of Krishna. Yasya prasada bhagavat prasada. One who desires to advance in spiritual life, but he acts whimsically, not following the orders of the spiritual master, has no shelter. Yasya prasada nagati katopi. Without the spiritual master's order, even the grihastha should not indulge in sex life. Text 12. Brahmacharis or grihasthas who have taken the vow of celibacy as described above should not indulge in the following: applying powder or ointment to the eyes, massaging the head with oil, massaging the body with the hands, seeing a woman or painting of a woman's picture, eating meat, drinking wine, decorating the body with flower garlands, smearing scented ointment on the body, or decorating the body with ornaments. These they should give up. Texts 13 and 14. According to the rules and regulations mentioned above, one who is twice born, namely a brahmana, kshatriya, or vaishya, should reside in the gurukul under the care of the spiritual master. There he should study and learn all the Vedic literatures according, along with their supplements and the Upanishads according to his ability and power to study. If possible, the student or disciple should reward the spiritual master with remuneration the spiritual master requests, and then, following this master's order, the disciple should leave and accept one of the other ashrams, namely the Grihastha ashram, Vanaprastha ashram, or Sannyasa ashram, as he desires. Purport. To study the Vedas and understand them, of course, requires some special intelligence, but the members of the three higher sections of society, namely the Brahmanas, Kshatriyas, and Vaishyas, must learn the Vedic literatures according to their capability and power to understand. In other words, studying the Vedic literatures is compulsory for everyone but the Shudras and Atyagyas. The Vedic literature gives the knowledge that can lead one to understand the Absolute Truth, Brahman, Paramatma, or Bhagavan. Gurukul, or the reformatory educational institution, should be used only to understand Vedic knowledge. At the present time, there are many educational institutions for training and technology, but such knowledge has nothing to do with understanding of the Absolute Truth. Technology, therefore, is meant for the Shudras, whereas the Vedas are meant for the Dvijas. Consequently, this verse states, Dvija dhyatva bhutya chatrayam sango pani sadam. At the present time, in the age of Kali, practically everyone is a Shudra and no one is a Dvija. Therefore, the condition of society has very much deteriorated. Another point to be observed from this verse is that from the brahmachari ashram, one may accept the sannyasa ashram, vanaprastha ashram, or grihastha ashram. It is not compulsory for a brahmachari to become a grihastha. Because the ultimate aim is to understand the absolute truth, there is no necessity of going through all the different ashrams. Thus, one may proceed to the sannyasa ashram directly from the brahmachari ashram. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur accepted the sannyasa ashram directly from the brahmachari ashram. In other words, his divine grace, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, did not think it compulsory to accept the grihastha ashram or vanaprastha ashram. Text 15. One should realize that in the fire, the spiritual master, in the spiritual master, in oneself, and in all living entities, in all circumstances and conditions, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vishnu, has simultaneously entered and not entered. He is situated eternally and internally, or externally and internally, as the full controller of everything. Purport. Realization of the Supreme Personality of Godhead's omnipresence is the perfect realization of the absolute truth to be obtained through the study of the Vedic literatures. It is stated in the Brahma Samhita 5:35, Adantarasta Paramanu Chayantarastam. The Lord is situated within the universe, within the heart of every living entity, and also within the atom. We should understand that whenever the Supreme Personality of Godhead is present, he is present with all his paraphernalia, including his name, form, associates, and servants. The living entity is a part and parcel of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and thus one should understand that since the Supreme Lord has entered the atom, the living entity is there also. One must accept the inconceivable quality of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, for no one can understand from the material point of view how the Lord is all-pervasive and yet is situated in his own abode, Goloka Vrindavan. This realization is possible if one strictly follows the regulative principles of ashram, brahmacharya, grihastha, pranaprastha, and sannyas. Srila Madhvacharya says in this regard, apravista sarvagata pravistas tu anurupavan evam dvi rupu bhagavan hari eko janardana. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, in his original form, has not entered everything, apravista, but in his impersonal form, he has entered, pravista. Thus, he has entered and not entered simultaneously. This is explained in Bhagavad Gita 9:4, wherein the Lord says, mayam etatam idam sarvam jagat avyaktimurtina matstani sarvabhutani nachaham tvevavashtita. Quote, by me, in my unmanifested form, this entire universe is pervaded. All beings are in me, but I am not in them, end quote. The Lord can defy himself. Thus, there is variety in unity. Ekatvam bahutvam. Text 16. By practicing in this way, whether one be in the brahmachari ashram, grihastha ashram, vanaprastha ashram, or sannyasa ashram, one must always realize the all-pervading presence of the Supreme Lord. For in this way, it is possible to understand the absolute truth. Purport. This is the beginning of self-realization. One must first understand how Brahman is present everywhere and how he is acting. This education is called Brahma Jignasa and is the real concern of human life. Without such knowledge, one cannot claim to be a human being. Rather, he remains in the animal kingdom. As it is said, Saiva Gokara, without such knowledge, one is no better than a cow or an ass. Text 17. O King, I shall now describe the qualifications for a vanaprastha, one who has retired from family life. By rigidly following the rules and regulations for the vanaprastha, one can easily be elevated to the upper planetary system known as Mahar Loka. Text 18. A person in vanaprastha life should not eat grains grown by tilling of the fields. He should also not eat grains that have grown without tilling the field but are not fully ripe. Nor should a vanaprastha eat grains cooked in fire. Indeed, he should eat only fruit ripened by the sunshine. Text 19. A vanaprastha should prepare cakes to be offered in sacrifice from fruits and grains grown naturally in the forest. When he obtains some new grains, he should give up his old stock of grains. Text 20. A vanaprastha should prepare a thatched cottage or take shelter of a cave in a mountain only to keep the sacred fire, but he should personally practice enduring snowfall, wind, rain, fire, and the shining of the sun. Text 21. The vanaprastha should wear matted locks of hair on his head and let his body hair and nails and mustache grow. He should not cleanse the dirt body, his body of dirt. He should keep a water pot, deer skin, and rod, wear the tree bark of a tree as covering, and use garments colored like fire. Text 22. Being very thoughtful, a vanaprastha should remain in the forest for 12 years, 8 years, 4 years, 2 years, or at least 1 year. He should behave in such a way that he will not be disturbed or troubled by too much austerity. Text 23. When because of disease or old age, one is unable to perform his prescribed duties for advancement in spiritual consciousness or study of the Vedas, he should practice fasting, not taking any food. Text 24. He should properly place the fire element in his own self, and in this way give up bodily affinity, by which one thinks the body to be one's self or one's own. One should gradually merge the material body into the five elements, earth, water, fire, air, and sky. Purport. The body is an effect of a cause, namely the five material elements, earth, water, fire, air, and sky. In other words, one should know perfectly well that the material body is nothing but a combination of the five elements. This knowledge constitutes merging of the material body and the five material elements. Merging into Brahman in perfect knowledge means understanding perfectly that one is not the body but a spiritual soul. Text 25. A sober, self-realized person who has full knowledge should merge the various parts of the body in their original sources. The holes in the body are caused by the sky. The process of breathing is caused by the air. The heat of the body is caused by fire. And semen, blood, and mucus are caused by water. The hard substances, like skin, muscle, and bone, are caused by earth. In this way, all the constituents of the body are caused by various elements, and they should be merged again into those elements. Purport. To be self-realized, one must understand the original source of the various elements of the body. The body is a combination of skin, bone, muscle, blood, semen, urine, stool, heat, breath, and so on, which all come from earth, water, fire, air, and sky. One must be well conversant with the sources of all the bodily constituents. Then one becomes a self-realized person, or Atmavan, one who knows the self. Text 26 through 28. Thereafter, the body is the object of speech along with the sense of speech, the tongue, should be bestowed upon fire. Craftsmanship and the two hands should be given to the demigod Indra. The power of movement and the legs should be given to Lord Vishnu. Sensual pleasure along with the genitals should be bestowed upon Prajapati. The rectum with the power of evacuation should be bestowed in its proper place to Mrityu. The oral instrument, along with sound vibration, should be given to the deities presiding over the directions. The instrument of touch, along with the sense objects of touch, should be given to Vayu. Form, with the power of sight, should be bestowed upon the sun. The tongue, along with the demigod Varuna, should be bestowed upon water. And the power of smell, along with the two Ashwini Kumar demigods, should be bestowed upon the earth. Text 29 through 30. The mind, along with all material desires, should be merged in the moon demigod. All the subject matters of intelligence, along with the intelligence itself, should be placed in Lord Brahma. False ego, which is under the influence of the material modes of nature, which induces one to think, quote, I am this body and everything connected with this body is mine, end quote, should be merged along with material activities in Rudra, the predominating deity of false ego. Material consciousness, along with the goal of thought, should be merged in the individual living being, and the demigods acting under the modes of material nature should be merged along with the perverted living entity into the supreme being. The earth should be merged into water, water in the brightness of the sun, this brightness into the air into the sky into the false ego into the total material energy into the unmanifested ingredients, the pradhana feature of the material energy, and at last the ingredient feature of material manifestation into the supersoul. Text 31. When all the material designations have thus merged into their respective material elements, the living beings who are all ultimately completely spiritual, being one in quality with the Supreme Being, should cease from material existence, as flames cease when the wood in which they are burning are consumed. When the material body is returned to its various material elements, only the spiritual being remains. This spiritual being is Brahman and is equal in quality with Parabrahman. Thus end the Bhaktivedanta purports of the 7th canto, 12th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, entitled The Perfect Society, Four Spiritual Classes.